Hey, Dr. Bernard here. This case was recorded in October 1841. It was published in a book in 1908. Humans react to chemicals the same way today as they did back then. Parts of this case I've adapted for today, but I've preserved as much of the original description as possible. The poisoning still happens today in a working space that didn't exist in the 1800s, all of which I will tell you about later in this video. A scientist inhaled 3 liters of gas he made in a balloon. This is what happened to his kidneys. MB is a 31-year-old man presenting to the emergency room with a pain between his legs. He tells the admitting nurse that over the last 4 hours, he kept emptying his stomach into the laboratory sink. At first, it was forcefully projectile, but as the time continued, it became green in color. MB was a scientist writing a book about chemicals. He had a good career and a good reputation as a teacher. MB loved to make jokes in the lab. Science is supposed to be fun, he thought. He would make gases from chemical reactions and inhale them. This would change his voice for a short amount of time. All of his students found this hilarious. His voice could become high, his voice could become low. He found this effect funny, and he kept thinking of new ways to inhale different gases to find his voice. One day, MB mixed some metal shavings with sulfuric acid. He collected the resulting hydrogen gas in a balloon, knowing that it would make his voice an exceptionally high pitch, and because this gas is light, it would just make its way out of his lungs, and it'll be no problem, he thought. Immediately after inhaling what was supposed to be hydrogen gas in the balloon, MB felt light like a feather. His voice was high-pitched and he could hear the resonance ring throughout his skull as he felt like he was floating around in the air. Looking at the balloon, he saw there was enough for one more as he breathed it in and he felt on top of the world. He was seized with giddiness and his vision felt lightweight as it started turning dark. But then he started to notice that he was shivering and shaking. At first, it was subtle, but then he noticed that his legs started to hurt. The pain got worse and worse as he could start to feel his heart beating in his feet as his hands started tingling and going numb. He went into the bathroom and noticed that his urine could only trickle out, and what did come out was a deep red color. As the hours passed, contents from MB's stomach kept coming up. It was projectile before it became green, and it brought him down to the floor. He struggled to call for 911 as he's brought to the emergency room, where we are now. At examination, the medical team noticed that MB's skin felt cold to the touch. His heart rate was high, and his stomach contents that came up were green, maybe a little yellow. When he could talk, his voice seemed weak, and his face and the whites of his eyes were also a greenish-yellow color, meaning that he's jaundiced. The color comes from a chemical called bilirubin, something that makes feces brown and is produced from breaking down red blood cells in the liver. All of this meaning that there could be some liver damage happening to MB. He told them about the hydrogen gas that he inhaled before this happened, but he was unsure if it was really the gas causing all of these problems, because hydrogen doesn't just do something like this. As the night continued, the team noted that every hour on the hour, MB would have a stomach movement come up out of his mouth. They noticed that MB stopped urinating. He seems bloated. His face and his belly are swollen as if he's retaining fluid that should be urine. A blood test finds that MB has anemia, and meaning without, and emia meaning presence of blood. Something called hemoglobin was low in his blood, which is the protein that carries oxygen throughout the body. Without oxygen going to vital parts like the brain, bad things can start to happen. But examining his red urine, they find out that what's making it red is huge amounts of hemoglobin. Clearly, something is happening to his liver if he appears jaundiced, and if he had hemoglobinuria before he completely stopped making urine altogether, then it means that something happened to his kidneys too, but why? MB inhaled what should have been hydrogen gas. Typically, you don't get sick like this just by breathing that in, but everything started to go wrong after that particular moment. If he inhaled something, then why are bad things happening to his liver and his kidneys, but not his lungs? In the lungs, the oxygen from the air is exchanged for carbon dioxide from the blood. If inhaled gas from the lungs goes directly into the blood, and MB noticed blood in his urine before he presented to the emergency room, then it means that gas may have done something to his blood. That bad blood could have flown into his kidneys and become his urine, and this gives the medical team some clues as to what's happening. As the days pass, MB's vomiting episodes become less frequent. His jaundice disappeared. It looked like he was getting better. But then doctors noticed that he was bloated, like he was holding on to water. They noticed that he hadn't urinated for several days now, when they inserted a catheter into his bladder to drain it, hoping that there'd be a bunch of urine in there, they find that it's completely empty. MB's kidneys have completely stopped working. He could respond to commands, he could hold a conversation, he knew where he was, but as the fifth day of being in the hospital continued, he started to become drowsy and tired. There could be something wrong with his brain, but that's not likely given that he could speak and move. But all of that could mean that not enough oxygen might be getting to his brain for some reason, bringing us back to his anemia, his hemoglobinuria, and the idea of gas exchange in the lungs. Analysis of the metal shavings and the sulfuric acid that MB used to create the hydrogen gas that he packed into his lungs finds substantial contamination of the element arsenic. If the mixture reacted to form gas, then it means that the hydrogen that MB thought he inhaled was actually arsine. This toxic gas exchanged in his lungs and started pushing into his blood. It started spreading everywhere, all throughout his body, and this explains everything happening to him. The air that we breathe in is not mostly oxygen, it's almost 80% nitrogen. On the periodic table, nitrogen is a light element. It's one of the most abundant elements in living beings. It's mostly a gas on Earth, but when it's combined with hydrogen, it becomes ammonia. In a column, known as a group, on the table, elements have similar features. They're not exactly the same because as you go down the column, elements get heavier. They become more unstable, meaning that they could be more reactive. If nitrogen and hydrogen make up ammonia, then phosphorus, which is also abundant in the body, can combine with hydrogen to make phosphine, which is a poison gas that can cause spontaneous human combustion when in the body. This also means that arsenic can combine with hydrogen to make arsine, which is what MB inhaled when he produced the gas in his balloon from contaminated reagents. These chemical properties don't tell us directly how and why bad things happen when someone inhales arsine gas. It's not immediately obvious, and experiments haven't given us a better idea at the moment. But we do know what happens, because it's happening to MB. In the blood cells, arsine weakens the globin chains holding down heme. We know this because it only happens to regular hemoglobin that's found in all healthy humans. It doesn't happen to hemoglobin exposed to carbon monoxide, the chemical known to bind stronger to hemoglobin than oxygen and can cause someone to suffocate when it's present. Arsine strips out the heme in regular hemoglobin of a red blood cell and sends the heme to float around in the body, and this is one part of where the problems come from. Heme contains iron. The form of iron that arsine strips out is reactive. It can cause damage to all different parts of the body. One of the places in the body that can't handle this reactive iron is the kidneys. The heme lodges into the tubules, and this pigment causes oxidative damage and necrosis as the tissue dies. In MB, this is what happened to him because he started urinating a red color. It explains his anemia because the hemoglobin was getting cut out by the arsine. It explains the hemoglobin in the urine before his kidneys completely stopped working and he no longer made any urine for days while he was in the hospital. The idea of poison arsenic goes back to ancient times because it was an untraceable way to get rid of someone. But while the ancient world knew arsenic as a poison, it also knew it as a medicine. In Han Dynasty China, 2,000 years ago, a published book titled The Sen Nong Ben Cao Jing is an ancient pharmacopoeia still available in print today. It recorded the use of an arsenic compound to treat jaundice, ulcers, parasitic infections, and malignant growths. What's poison becomes medicine, and what's old becomes new again, bringing us to today. In 1971, in Harbin City in the north of China, the local government caught wind of an herbalist dispensing cancer treatments. They sent an official to inspect exactly what these treatments were, and they discovered that it was a mix of toad extract, mercuric oxide, and arsenic trioxide. This mixture was tested in a particular blood cancer called acute promyelocytic leukemia. Promyelocyte being a young, immature type of blood cell, leuk from Greek leukos meaning white, referring to the kind of blood cell, and emia meaning presence in blood. Immature white blood cell presence in blood. This appears in the body as a cancer. Arsenic trioxide was used to achieve complete remission in 21 out of 32 patients with this particular blood cancer, published in Chinese medical literature in 1992, with study rationale deriving from a fusion of traditional and modern medical ideas. The idea of arsenic as a treatment for acute promyelocytic leukemia crossed over from China to one of the largest cancer centers in the United States, and published in English literature in 1998, 11 of 12 patients with acute promyelocytic leukemia were in remission after treatment containing arsenic trioxide. Today, we see this in the news. An American football player playing for the Houston Texans was recently diagnosed with acute promyelocytic leukemia. His treatment might contain therapeutic arsenic, given that a regimen with it is a standard of care. Semiconductor manufacturing to make computer chips relies on a step that needs ion implantation, where a gas is used to implant metal on a wafer. And it's here where arsenic is deposited on chips through the use of arsine gas, as it's used today. This is an occupational hazard for people working in the space that happens today. It's a workspace that didn't exist in the 1800s, bringing us back to MB. On his sixth day in the hospital, MB passed seven stools that were likely a watery consistency, consistent with arsenic poisoning. The medical team found that he did make some urine, but all of it was red. As the day passed, he became weak and bloated as the sun started to set. Arsine gas was discovered in 1775. The first recorded case of poisoning was in 1815 Germany, where the chemist accidentally exposed himself to the gas. These accidents would happen around the time the hot air balloon was invented, because to inflate the balloon with hydrogen gas, sulfuric acid was mixed with iron, and because both would be contaminated with arsenic, people would suffer illness and be found not alive days later, just like MB. At autopsy, doctors tested MB's body fluids. They found the same concentration of arsenic that was found on the sulfuric acid and the metal shavings that he used to make the gas that he inhaled. The test that doctors used to find the arsenic in MB is the same test that put a stop to the French calling arsenic the powder of inheritance, because it's easily provable once the arsenic can be detected. But as sophisticated as doctors were at the time to detect arsenic after the fact, they didn't know how to treat arsine gas poisoning back then. Today, we can try to stop the kidney damage from arsine by exchange transfusion. This will take out the patient's broken blood and replace it with donor blood that doesn't have arsenic in it. Today, sulfuric acid shouldn't have arsenic contamination in it. Iron still does sometimes. In everyday life, regular people aren't typically going to come into abundant contact with arsenic and arsine gas. General rule of thumb in line with MB's case, if you don't need to put it in your lungs, don't put it in your lungs. If recognized early, and if the arsine exposure wasn't too much, patients can come out okay. For MB, given that he was alive six more days in the hospital after he accidentally inhaled that 3 liters of arsine gas, he could have been saved if his case happened today, but they didn't know how or have the tools to do so back then on October 23rd, 1841. Thanks so much for watching. Take care of yourself and be well.